Jesus is how I can raise up ordinary men, turning them to become supernatural beings, financial bosses, making life better, bringing people from the dungeon of sin, bringing them into the faith, planting their feet, and rising them.
Thank you, Father. Give Jesus some clamp offering. I have just 2 verses of scriptures to read, then we have our seat. We're going to stand, we will read it chorously all together, then we sit down on heavenly places. Shall we stand up for the reading? Romans chapter 8 from verse 18 to 19. I want us to read chorously. 1, 2, go. For I reckon that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. In verse 19, for the endless expectation of the creature awaited the manifestation of the sons of God. Let's read verse 19. For the earnest expectation of the creature awaited the manifestation of the sons of God. Father, we thank you for the reading of the word. Sit down on your enemy's head. I want to share with us on what I titled The Manifestation of Uncommon Leaders. The Manifestations of Uncommon Leaders. How many of us are pastors here, leaders here? You are a pastor, you are a leader. Please, can you lift up your hands? Let me see you. Or a pastor wife, you are a leader. Lift up your hands. Very well. I want to see. I want you to stand up. I want to know the amount of leaders I'm talking to. Pastors, leader, leader wife, that is good. That is wonderful. That is wonderful. The manifestation of uncommon leaders. The Bible said in the book of Romans chapter 8, in verse 18, for I reckon that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Whatever you are going through now, whatever you are experiencing now, it cannot be compared to what God is about to do in the next 1 month, 6 months, 1 year, 2 years. It cannot be compared. Not outside, but in you.
Amen.
I have discovered that the deeper, the stronger, the tougher the suffering of a man and the challenge of a man become, the more higher God is about to reveal him to the world. Let me tell you, if you are going through something now as a pastor or a pastor wife, you are being rejected. And let me tell you, in this conference, when I'm talking about pastor, it is not only pastors that are leaders. Hello? You can become a leader economically through business. You can become a leader politically through politics. You can become a leader career-wise through your career as a doctor, as a medical doctor, or a lawyer, or as a civil servant. You can become a leader. You can become a leader as a minister of the gospel. So it depends on what kind of leader you are aspiring to. Every one of us are leaders in our own capacity. For example, if you are a husband, you are a leader to your wife and your children. Am I communicating? And so you lead. And he that cannot rule his house
cannot lead a church. So leadership starts from the nuclear family. Even though you are a wife, you are a leader under a leader. So your husband is in charge, and you too, you are sub in charge of the family. So am I communicating? And even though you are a son, you might be the first son, and so your other siblings are looking onto you as a role model. Am I communicating? So I'm talking about leadership, it is in different category. Don't exclude yourself in this leadership teaching. Every one of us is relevant, and the message is the manifestation of the uncommon leader. And let me tell you this, before the manifestation, there is usually a kind of a dark era in the life of anyone who aspire to become a leader. Anyone who wants to become great, anyone who wants to get to the top, anyone who wants to be relevant, anyone who wants to be better, any man who has desire to get to the top. Each time I hear people say, I am on the top, I ask myself, what is the story behind the glory? If you don't have the story to tell me, I cannot envy your glory. Can I talk to somebody? If you don't have a story to tell me, I can't even follow you. There are people that just come overnight that make you feel that they landed from heaven and became what they become overnight. Leaders are not made overnight. They grow into leadership. We don't jump into leadership. We grow into leadership. We don't jump into greatness. We grow into greatness. Am I talking to somebody here? God does not bypass process for progress. There is a process for every man to follow to get to the top. Hello? Am I communicating? I've heard people say, I am a born leader. I am a born leader. I said, that's a statement that is pregnant with a lot of disagreement. Am I communicating? Leaders are made. They are not just born. Am I communicating? They are made. They follow through process. Jesus told the disciple, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. So you must understand that they are not just born overnight. They are made. They follow through process. There is a making that makes them a leader. Am I communicating? It is only in the ministry I just see somebody say, I am a pastor, and they become a pastor. Is it possible for somebody to come up and tell you, I'm a pilot? Say, yes, I am a pilot. And now he now tell you, enter into the aeroplane. I want to fly you. I'm sure you are about to announce your obituary before the time. Pilots are not born. They are trained. Hello? Have you ever seen a born pilot? Yeah, am I communicating? We make it look as if pastors are born overnight. I'm a born prophet. It's true. But then there must be a training. Without training, there can be no reigning. If you are not trainable, you are not traceable. If you are not trainable, you are not traceable. So the secret of your reigning is your training. So you must understand. Have you ever seen a medical doctor that said, I am a born doctor? He just came up and said, they born me, I am a doctor. Now, lie down, let me dissect your stomach. Are you sure you will allow him to carry the knife? I'm sure it's total death, obituary before time. It is only in the ministry I've seen people say, overnight, I am born. No! We have to follow a process. A process. A process. A process. A process. I have not seen a born driver. No matter how gifted and skillful you are, you cannot be born a driver. You must be trained to be a driver. If not, you will kill everybody. In other words, if a pastor is called and is not trained to understand his calling, he will become an abuse to that office. I am called to be a prophet, not just a called prophet, but a trained prophet. We have rascal prophets. Rascal prophets. They prophesy. They can see your bank account, but they can't see your problem. When they say, I see, I see, I see.
your bank account. Fine. After you see my bank account, have you seen the problem? So their eyes, their prophetic eye is to see your bank account and to collect your money and not to solve the problem. So it's a 419 anointing. Hello? I am a call evangelist. You have to be a trained evangelist, not just call. If not, you will be all over the whole world. At the end, you will not have a house. You become a nomadic farmer. Have you seen Fulanis? Those are rare animals. They move their cow from one location to the other, so they cannot build solid house. There are some evangelists, they spend 30 years nothing to show, because there's nobody to teach them how to do ministry like the way Rena Bonke has done his own and make impact. You must learn. Leaders are learners. Leaders are readers. Leaders are learners. Leaders are readers. Before you lead, how many books have you read in the area of your calling? How many books have you read? How many people have you heard in the area of your calling? When you are called to be a prophet, get books on prophetic ministry. Get materials on prophetic ministry. Look for people that are ahead of you in prophetic ministry. Listen to them. You have to be trained. If you are not trained, you will become an abuse to that office. I am a called pastor. You cannot just be a called pastor alone. A called, trained pastor. If not, you will beat your members in the church. Pastoral ministry need patience. If you don't know how to handle human being, don't call yourself a pastor. Because, my God, when members gather, there are scorpions, there are lions, there is goat, there is snake, there is fish, and there is sheep. So all of them gather. It's not everybody that are sheep. And you are called to lead sheep. So as a pastor, you have to turn snake to sheep, turn goat to sheep, turn lion to sheep. If not, you can't lead them. You have to understand human behavior. Human behavior. When you are, I'm talking pastoral ministry is one of the difficult ministries to do. The ability to make 200 people to go, next Sunday return back. It is capacity of pastoral impact. You are not called to gather crowd. You are called to gather members. Followers. And if you don't know how to pastor them, you become an insult to that office. If there is any kind of person that people easily criticize, it's a pastor. Because 365 days they sit down under you, they hear you, they want to see something new. You can't just come last Sunday, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Amen. Fire. And next week, Sunday again, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. They say, hey, this pastor, is it for God so loved the world that he only know? Fire. I'm sure when you repeat one sermon 3 months, you will lose 30 members 3 months. They want new thing. Pastors must study to show themselves approved as a workman that needed not to be ashamed, but rightly dividing the word of truth. Hello? Leaders are not made by appointment. Leaders are made by training. Ministry is not just the gathering of people, but equipping people for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not enough to say, I am called. You must be choosing. Many are called, but few are choosing. Say, I'm called. It's not enough to say, I'm called. You must be choosing. And if you are called, know what you are called to do. The earth is waiting for some of us here. You see, the next part of the scripture, he said, for the earnest expectation of the creature, the world is awaiting the manifestations of the sons of God. Do you know that there are some people just sitting down waiting for you to manifest? Because their destiny is tied to your life. If you don't manifest, they cannot be delivered. Some of you hold the miracle of some people in your body. Some blind are waiting for you to manifest. Some cripples are waiting for you to manifest. Some sick are waiting for you to manifest. Some people that have left and lack direction in life are waiting for you to manifest. If you don't manifest, they cannot shine. And that's why I came to catafire you to manifest. I didn't hear that amen well. You are not a local champion. You are not born to watch others. Even though you are not a pastor, here, hear this. So there are some of you that read newspaper and talk about people that are on top. When will somebody talk about you? When will they talk about you? When will they read about you? When will they read about you? Nelson Mandela has done his own, and he has exited this earth. History will never forget him in a jiffy. He is not a pastor, he's not a preacher, but yet he's a role model to so many people. Why? He had something to die for, something to stand for, something to stand for. It has never been seen in the history of the world where presidents of country gather just for one man. The man have died, but they gather to pay last respect. Do you know what it means? A black man commanding president of US, all other president, kings. Why? Because Nelson Mandela dared to do something uncommon. I'm not just a pastor, but a leader that can influence others. Am I talking to somebody here? People should not just love you because you preach the gospel. They should love you because you have a quality of a true leader. Unbelievers look at you. They just want to be like you. Am I talking to somebody here? It's not because you carry the Bible. You are even on jeans and on little top, but they are looking at you. They say, we want to be like him. You don't have the Bible in your hand, but when you talk, the quality of Jesus is seen. The quality of good character is seen. What is the excess of preaching powerful sermon talking about Jesus, but yet when it is time to behave it, you cannot behave it? There are sisters who sing powerful songs on the altar, who are ushers, who are leaders, who are very wonderful in the church. Go to their workplace. You will not see any quality of God in them. Ask about them at the place of work. Hello? Do you know sister this? They say, did you say sister? What did you say? That one that fights everywhere, fights all the staff, malice everybody, hits two heads together. It is only in the church they know her as a born-again sister. But when she gets out there, her character is the opposite of what she portrays. True Christianity is not carrying Bible. True Christianity is carrying Bible inside you. Bible is living inside you. Somebody did not see Bible, but when you talk, they know this is a child of God. When you see something, you say, if Jesus is here, he will not do this. So I will not do it. It is in the body of Christ you see the level of unforgiveness among preachers, pastors. They can keep malice. They can keep malice. Do you know the reason why pastors keep malice is very, very funny? Let me explain. A pastor does print posters. People come for his program. Another pastor will send his protocols. You see how we are raising up mafians. Go and watch how many of our members went to that program. Then you will see protocols. Who are supposed to see the gathering as the gathering of the of God? They will come into the program. They will sit down. Hey, Sister Vero is there. Write her name down. Hey, Choir Master is there. Write his name down. Hey, Chief Protocol is there. Write his name down. Hey, hey, your April PA is there. Hey, write his name down. Now, all those, you see why pastors lose members? Now, they will bring the report to the man of God who did not come for the program. Now he will invite them to the office. Why did you went for that program? I hear what? I will threat, I will curse you. You will die under 7 days. Do you know how dangerously anointed I am? Where is it written in the Bible? Now, that man of God that did that program, that did not know that the member of that other man of God attended that program, will become a problem. The pastor will begin to malice another pastor, and the pastor never knew anything that happened. Why? We protect members as if our blood can save one of them. If you are too conscious of members leaving your church is small and it's not growing. When you have a growing church, you will not police your members. I pray for the pastor here. May God take you to a level where you don't know whether members come or they don't come. Did you hear that prayer? I say, may God take you to a level where you don't know whether members come or they don't come.
Amen.
It's not that you are not a caring pastor, but it is a progress that is made in the work. I prophesy, you will have over breakthrough of Christ.
Amen.
If unbelievers can forgive one another, why will pastor not forgive one another? Why? How can a man be jailed for how many years? And after he came back not with the gospel of bitterness. I'm talking about Nelson Mandela. Not with the gospel of bitterness. Talking about reconciliation. Talking about love. He's not a pastor. I say it's not. Do you know what it means? Just try to be in jail for 2 months. You will understand what it means. That's a true portion of love. I pray for you. That kind of love that kills hatred, may he enter your life. Shout the amen like thunder.
Amen.
You cannot manifest until certain things are destroyed. There are certain pollutants that can pollute the grace that a man of God carry, that will not make a man of God to be effective, that will not make a man of God to move forward. I call them little fox that spoils the vine. These are the reason why some of us cannot manifest in ministry. The reasons why some leaders can't manifest in ministry. Number one, it's lack of integrity. Proverbs 20 verse 7. Integrity is not what people say about you. What people say about you is their reputation. Integrity is what God says about you. People can say you are a genuine man of God, and God does not know you to be genuine. So what people say about you is your reputation. And your reputation does not stand when God is speaking. I have seen people criticize men of God because people are against the man of God. That everybody all over the world is saying the man of God is fake. He does not make him fake until God say the man is fake. There are men of God that we celebrate. In fact, if a man of God is not criticized, I suspect the man of God.
Because if you are against the devil must wage war against you. So if everybody is talking good about you, there is something satanic about you. There's something barbaric about you. Until somebody begins to talk something evil about you, then you are a terrorist to the kingdom of darkness. If you are not against the devil, he will support you. But if you are against him, he will attack you. So I've heard people say, I will not near that man of God because people criticize him. That's not it. Ask yourself, God revealed this man to me. Look at it. We have the gift of discernment of the spirit. You don't design a man through the flesh. When a man of God is preaching, you are watching him either from television or anywhere. You ask the Holy Spirit, reveal this man of God to me. Can I teach here? Can I teach here? Do you know one of the things we use to judge a man of God? It is the mistake of a man of God. Men of God can make mistake. Hello? They can make mistake. They are not perfect. And if anyone tell you he's perfect, watch him, you will see his imperfection. Everywhere is looking at me quietly. I say men of God make mistake. And that they make mistake, it does not make them fake. Hello? Abraham, is he not a friend of God? Is he not a friend of God? And a father of what? Faith. God told him, your seed through Sarah, I'm going to give and build covenant with. And the Bible says, Abraham staggered not at the promises of God. When God cover up for a man, thank God for it too. But look at it very, very well. Abraham staggered. It means he staggered not. It means he did not look left and right. A time came in the life of Abraham. Sarai told Abraham, look, we have been waiting. Baby never come. No child. Please, go in and sleep with our housemaid so that we can have a child. And that's how Agai came. But the question I ask you, if Abraham is a father of faith, why should he yield to the advice of Sarah? Why should he doubt God and go for Sarah? Check the Bible. Immediately, Sarah said, Abraham, sleep with my housemaid. Abraham did not even question Sarah or say, God forbid. He did not argue at once. Bam, he slept with Agai. Bam, he was already eyeing that housemaid before that time. It was an opportunity for him to manifest. Read your Bible. Go and check your Bible. If your wife tells you to sleep with another woman, wouldn't you argue? Wouldn't you say, shut up there? Abraham never told Sarah, shut up. At once, bam, he slept with Agai. At once, Agai became pregnant. Bam, Ishmael came. Bam. And the Bible said, he staggered not at the promises of God. But in the literal sense, when a man deviates at that level, what do you think has happened? He has doubted God that he cannot have a child. So he looked for another way. That's why you and I are suffering up to today from one patriarch of faith. He made the mistake. From him came out the Christian race. From him came out the other race. So you must understand, one expensive mistake of a leader can cause a problem, but does not make him illegitimate. God saw it as a mistake and never used it against him. Hello? You don't judge a man by his mistake. Hello? Have you read about David? A man after God's heart. When the Bible says man after God's heart is man, he was the beloved of God. How can a beloved of God send another man to the battlefield, took over his wife, killed a man? Hello? Have you read about a man called Peter?
the most brave disciple. He denied Jesus 3 times. Number 1, coincidence. Number 2, mistake. Number 3, deliberate. And yet, he is still one of the disciples Jesus gave the baton of leadership to. So you must understand, draw a tiny line between a mistake of man of God and calling him a false prophet.
You that is hearing me now, as I'm talking to you, check your life.
How many times have you made mistake? Even before you came here, who did you fight with? Who did you insult on phone? Who did you send text to? Does it make you fake?
I'm teaching you something here. You have to be very careful of the way we pass judgment on the children of God, not understanding that there is a difference between when a man of God is making mistake and when God is lifting the man from imperfection to perfection. Hear what the Bible said. He said, when we all see him, we will be like him. We are not perfect. We are striving to become perfect. It is until when he comes. So you must understand that he is only the perfect master. We are striving to be perfect. We are not yet perfect. Because when you get to that level of perfection, it is becoming a must that heaven will take you away.
Integrity.
And when you have integrity,
you will not sleep with members and pregnant them in the church.
There are pastors who have become special donor, donating every of the thing God has given them to everybody around the church.
Hello?
You cannot be praying for your church to grow and all the beautiful girls in the church, you are attacking them. You are attacking them with a ministry of compromise. You are not Solomon, but you are progressing in Solomon dimension.
Can I teach here?
Say, speak.
Some people are squeezing their face. You cannot stop me. I will talk.
I become afraid when a man of God have too many female protocols. Female on the right, female on the front, female at the back, female behind, everywhere, all around, women. And there is no brother. My brother, you are about to die. Your burial ceremony has come.
Hello?
Please, sister, don't get offended. Women are good. Women are good in ministry, but hear this. Why, how can you have 7 female protocol? What is happening to you? Even one brother is not there. And all the protocol, no pregnant woman, beautiful women, figure 8, Cinderella, all of them are following you up and down. They are going. You are writing love letter to your judgment day. No matter how anointed you are, you will backslide. You will backslide. You look by your right, you see fire. You look by your right, you see temptation. You look at your front, you see attraction. You look behind you, you see the deep of hell.
Hello.
You can't manifest, no matter how anointed you are, you can't manifest. There's nothing wrong in sister being your protocol, but please dilute it with small brothers. So that if there is temptation, you can see a brother face and reverse back. If the temptation is coming and you see another brother, you say, blood of Jesus, blood of Jesus, blood of Jesus, sustain me.
Hello. Am I blessing your life?
These are forks that spoils the vine. They don't make ministry to grow. They don't make the man of God who has the anointing to manifest. They don't make it to manifest. You must understand. Another thing, another fox that spoils the vine is unnecessary title. Title. There is title without entitlement. Your title without mantle equals to battle.
When you carry every man title, you are writing love letter to every battle. There is a way your title will drain all your anointing down. Ministry is not in title. It is the anointing that produces the work, that makes it work. Now, bearing a bishop is nothing bad. Bearing a bishop is nothing bad. But please, let your work correspond with the title. How can you have 10 members? You are archbishop. Where are you acting? Where is the bishop going to? 10 members. You are archbishop. And you don't have a car. You are on a bike. Hey! You are about to kill yourself. Because when you appear before people and say, I am archbishop, they now look around and say, no car. You are trekking. And you put on a big bishop cap, you are walking in the sun. Say, the Lord bless you, the Lord bless you. You are about to die. If you must bear that title, let your work correspond with it. That's what I'm saying. He that desire the office of a bishop, desire a good thing. There's nothing wrong in desiring that. But please, if you desire that, let your work correspond with that desire. Another reason why pastors can't manifest. You can't be a wife beater and become a God lover. How do you beat up your wife? There are pastors that beat up their wife and threaten them. As if you talk in the church, you are dead. I will kill you spiritually and kill you physically. Pastors' wives are suffering. They are suffering. You marry her, she was Cinderella. Good skirt, good shoe, good everything. But as soon as you marry her, you turn her to a magogo, to magogo. You see her, the way she's walking, the skirt has dropped down. The cloth has dropped down. She don't even understand whether she is in this world or she's out of this planet, because you are a wicked man of God. Wicked man of God. If you have love, let your love start to reflect on your wife. They should see your love on your wife. If your wife does not appear well, your ministry has failed. I said, if your wife is not a beneficiary of your anointing, your ministry has failed. What are you preaching? If the woman in the house cannot see what you are preaching in her life, you beat up. There are pastors, they slap the wife. Pah! And say, shut up there. I will slap you again and the blood of Jesus will cover your eyes. That's why you are preaching on the altar and your wife is sitting there and say, Nalai, Nalai. What does he say? Nalai, liar, Nalai. You are saying, Holy Ghost, move. Your wife say, Holy Ghost, don't move up. Remember the two slap is slapping. You must not move in this service. Am I blessing life? Look, if this message taught you, don't feel bad. Sow a seed and change. And that is it.